Greetings.
How are you?
I'm listening.
Great to meet you.
Ah, I've been expecting you.
For the good.
You come get the voodoo.
Hey there.
And you are...
Light be with you.
Great to meet
you. You come to consult the spirits?
Welcome to Orgrimmar. Have you come to serve the Horde?
Here, me buy and trade. What?
Hello and welcome to Ctrl, Alt, WoW, the podcast for those of us who love World of Warcraft and love making many alts. Today is Sunday, June 7th, 2020, and this is episode 666 entitled The Mark of the Alliance. I'm Aprilian, your host, and with me are my two awesome co-hosts. Hey, Constructs, how are you doing today?
I'm good. I'm stomping the Horde. I'm killing orcs left and right, destroying foreigns. And, I'm doing well.
Oh, okay. Good. Good to hear you. And Grand Negus, how are you?
I'm fine. I just earlier today found a Horde war mode chest on my 114 priest.
Oh.
So that was nice. We really had a good time taking care of those invaders. The Filthy Alliance. So.
Filthy Alliance.
Of course.
Yes. Hence the title, Mark of the Alliance, because it is six. Yeah. Episode 666. I think the last one we had that was bad, well, weirdly, was 13, so we've come a long way. Well, there was 420, but that was a whole nother episode.
Right.
All right. So what's going on this week? We got, of course, we have Dark Moon Fair.
Yeah.
Yep.
Every 4 weeks.
It starts today.
It started this morning at 12:01.
Yep. It started today. So
today, yeah. So we have a whole week.
Yep.
To get some extra rebuffs and what have you.
It also means I'm going to be able to get revered with the that faction, the Honeyhive faction. To start buying the goggles to look for the jelly. Because, as everyone knows, to get your mount, you have to farm jelly. And you can either buy it off the auction house.
Insane prices.
Insane prices.
Right?
Or you can go farm your own. If you're lucky in Stormsong Valley, you're just walking about and it's everywhere. But if you're unlucky... And you're just starting out at friendly, you can't find any. But I'm honored right now, and as I get to revered, you can buy goggles to look for it.
Oh, how cute! That's like those goggles they used to have for volatile air or something.
Yeah, the Ghost Iron in Pandaria.
Well, this was in the Grand, but yeah.
Oh, the Grand? Rock.
Looking for volatile air in the Grand?
Hmm.
Not in the Grand. I'm sorry.
I know you get. You got the item from the engineer. I just made one.
Right, but
to extract it from the
Zap Throttle Moat Extractor from Zangamarsh. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. No. Not okay. Anyways, it was a long time ago. But yes. Yeah. Okay. So that was fun. I mean that brings back the fun. But what was it? It was the area. Oh, man. It was way out where you had to do the battle for the air battle.
Wintergrass?
No, not Wintergrass. It was further out than Wintergrass. It'll come to me. Keep going. Like, I'm going to go find it right now.
The battle for Hala?
No.
With the 15 guards there? Once you killed all the guards, you could
use
the flag in the middle?
Yes, Hala. So it was Outland.
Yeah. Outland the Grand. Yeah.
Outland the Grand.
Netherstorm. No, was it Netherstorm? No.
No, Nagrand. Yeah, it's the PvP area there. Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Well, keep going.
Yeah, but we have the Thousand Boat Bash in Thousand Needles.
Right.
That starts Monday. So, and then we have the Battleground.
The Thousand Boat Bash started yesterday. It ends tomorrow. It ends Monday. But it started yesterday at 12:01.
Okay.
I'm just saying.
So then the show notes are wrong.
Okay.
Okay.
It must have been filmed by some filthy alliance.
Probably alliance.
Lead us to ruin.
They hacked the show.
We were hacked.
Right.
So, and then ending on Tuesday is the Battleground bonus event. And starting in its place is the Battle for Azeroth dungeon event. So, not all that much going on.
Right. Because there's a little bit of a lag or slowness because one of the best holidays is coming up in a couple of weeks.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I was just about to mention that we're going to have, like, in a week and a half.
Yeah.
I think, like, I'm not sure if it's, like, Friday or Saturday. I'm not in-game, so I don't know.
Oh, okay. Day. I'm in-game, I can tell you. It's going to start at 10 a.m. on Sunday, June 21st.
Okay, so, okay. And that's obviously Midsummer Fire Festival. So.
Right.
We can go and take care of those fires again.
Right, and put out fires.
Are you going to pee on my fires again? That's not right.
Yes.
No, it's pure necessity constructs.
And fun.
And fun.
Have fun running away as I chase you down.
Oh.
And lots of XP.
Yeah.
So with the bonus definitely. And everything, it'll be nice.
Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah, so that's basically it.
All right. Well, let's get started.
I've had a fantastic weekend. Wow. It's very comforting. Those battlegrounds where you're not necessarily putting out more damage, but you feel like you're contributing more by pushing all the buttons all at once. Bad boy. What you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you?
Guys, Drax, how's your week in WoW been?
My week in WoW kind of ground to a pulverizing halt as I killed Nalak over and over and over, and I opened him up on like 16 characters. So, trying to like get like a 1% chance to happen, but I would have to have him on 20 characters for a 1% chance to happen. And he didn't drop his mount, but he dropped an egg, which is kind of weird because the egg in a pouch usually contains one of three raptors, which I already have. But he dropped an egg, so I'll have to look at what's in the egg. But I would expect Nalak to drop the Nalak mount. You know, like the white pulsating lightning crystal jade serpent. I don't know. That's why I wanted to take a screenshot, put the screenshot on Twitters, because once it's on Twitters, then it's fact. Just like you
know. the serpent eggs you get from the cloud serpents, they're usually rep tokens.
Oh.
No, that's not the kind of egg I got. I got the egg that contains.
But that's the only egg that I know that they drop. But okay.
I'll put a screenshot in the show notes. I don't know why I dropped that. I dropped that on my DK. Mm-hmm. And later on that day after the reset. I went back in. Get this. I got up at 6 in the morning right before reset, and I did all my dailies with my rogue before reset happened. And I went to bed. And I thought, I know, I'll do my dailies again. But I was too tired. I waited 12 hours to do my other dailies. But I got the reputation for the Duvisay is on Winterhoof right now, killing it with the achievements as usual. And good to see you, Duvisay. She's in the chat room with us.
Hey, and
whatchamacallit, I was killing stuff on my rogue, and then I got to level 20 on the champion that follows you around in Najatar, and he offered me a mount, so I accepted. I got the weird sounding deep coral snapper.
Wait a minute, some stranger and just follows you around and offers you a mount, and you just take it?
I just took it. He had a question mark above his head. I've been level 20. We've known each other for a while. So I just took it. I thought it was at level 15 that he offered that, but it wasn't. It was actually at level 20. So you have to do it faithfully for at least 20 days. You get 3 quests a day. And you go up usually by 300 XP for the 3 quests, which is what it requires for a level. So I know there's a pet involved, and there's a toy involved. So now, Akana is like this great warrior who taunts a lot of stuff. So when you take him with you, sometimes you wind up dead because he ends up taunting everything all around. But as you go to get up in experience, he taunts a little smarter and keeps on the stuff that you're working on.
Oh.
But as you first began, it was rough. So I thought at level 20, I might as well try him against a 5,000 health, more XP health than I do, like one of the big elites. And I went in there, and I only had one or two people help me, and it took a long time until I figured out that the boss was healing it himself. So once the boss stopped healing himself, we got him down in like 2 minutes. But it was like, oh, I'm tanking it because my rogue is obviously set up for it to be a tank. And for some reason, I discovered my uncanny weapons that the sword is actually an agility sword. So I didn't know that. Usually the sword, when you have crafted weapon, a one-handed sword, is always a strength sword that you can sell to the tanks who are doing warrior and, Death Knight or... There's another strength class. I can't remember which. Paladin, yes. So there's usually 3 classes you can sell it to. But I guess because I'm a rogue, and rogue's main stat is agility, the stat does not transfer over if you switch spec from tanking to healing. So it's a purely an agility sword. So, you know, it's new to me, but... when you sell them on the auction house, they don't sell for 40,000 gold. They sell for about 20,000, which is a little bit less, because the monks can use them. The monks can use swords, apparently. So it's a little change in the strategy, I guess, for the stats and whatnot, and having different abilities for certain things. But it's good. It's good to have variety in the game. The only thing you can't control is the various random stats. So. Sometimes you get really, really good stats like the Harmonious, which is mastery, versatility. But other times you'll get the Peerless, which is not always favorable to whatever spec you're playing. So you're usually looking for a certain combination when you want to craft an item. Hopefully in the next expansion we'll have more to say about how we can craft the items, what extra bits and bobs we can add to make sure we get the stats that we want, that we can guarantee once.
Maybe we can guarantee tell you, you that, can.
Yeah.
You can choose what secondary stats you want by adding a by adding the respective gem to to your crafting. So if you want a theoretically, if you want an, strength. You get the strength and agility and all that stuff, and then you want mastery or haste or crit or whatnot. Yeah. You just add the respective gem to it, and then it'll reflect that in the secondary stats that the product puts out. So
I was lucky. I got a full set of gear for my rogue, so I got the corrupted set for the PvP, so that means I have a full set of 425 gear. Of course, I put it all in the scrapper because that's not what I'm looking for. I'm not looking for the 425. I'm looking for a higher eye level. Unfortunately, when you buy a different headset, it doesn't tell you what the secondary stats are. So sometimes you get a conquest head and or a conquest wrist or conquest bracers, and they don't match the multi-target or single-target combination that you're looking for in the stats. So sometimes those end up going in the scrapper because you don't know ahead of time what item you're going to pick, what stats you're going to get. Usually you find out on weapons what the stats are going to be. So that's why weapons are always, always preferable, because you get to know ahead of time what stats you're picking. But on the armor, you still have the random elements, so you're never really quite sure if it's going to work out quite how you plan. So I got a conquest head, and then I got another conquest item, and as I said before, I purified one of the items from my bracers last week, and so now I have a whole lot less self-damage inflicted. So I was actually able to kill stuff in PvP. I was able to kill a lot of casters. I was able to kill hunters. Still not able to do anything with warriors. Warriors just have too much cleave, too much stun, too much execute. They just have, by the time my outlaw rogue gets enough roll the bones to do anything, I'm down to 10% health. I did notice that some of the items you get in the bonus cash after a battleground, some of them restore 50% health. Some of them make you invisible for 6 seconds. Some of them, and that's despite things not going quite according to plan. You can still use those items to really annoy the other group. So if they've almost got you dead and everybody's blowing their cooldown to kill you because they don't want the rogue to vanish, and you pop your restore 50% health, that's a lot of primary abilities that you're getting rid of for them. And then I learned to bravely run away and find somewhere to hide so I can eat. I take food into every battleground. I take bandages into every battleground. So it's really annoying when somebody is down to 10% health, and then there's a rider coming up towards us, and you see the health bar ticking up and up and up as the bandage is doing its job. And bandages don't really cost that much. They made bandages really inexpensive. So if you have a tailor friend, just give him the cloth, get the bandages. Those are extremely handy in battlegrounds.
Oh,
you
wow.
don't have to be a healer
to use them. Okay, that's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, so you can put those up on the auction house.
Because I have a lot of bandages.
They're valuable. I don't know how they go to level up the profession, but I'm sure you could probably get a couple of points. I did not do as well on the auction house as I thought I would this week, just because I was just too tired. But I did sell like a couple of transmog items, you know, a couple of greens, a couple of toys, a few things here and there. I sold about 4 pets, which I'm still amazed after all this time that the Draenor pets are selling. Like it's not going away. I think what it is people move gold from server to server with those pets.
Right.
They just buy them when they're low and sell them where they can get more gold from them. And me, I just don't do the bartering at that level. I only have 3 or 4 servers that I sell on right now. And occasionally I'll sell on the server that I haven't sold for a while. And I'm doing pretty well on my home server, which is Thorin Brotherhood. But the other servers like Earthen Ring, I get stomped on when I go to PvP. I don't know what it is. I try like to get a little more XP that way, but the PvP players are really, really good on the Earthen Ring. Proudmoor, they're really good. So if you have somebody in your battle group, when you go into a BG that says, let's do this, and you read the Proudmoor caption, they're pretty good players in there. Like, I've had some solid groups. I finally understand what Deepwind Gorge is. It's more or less a redo of a Arathi Basin, but instead of having a big open hill configuration, you have little winding roads so that the objectives are kind of flat and in the open, but all of the lands to get to and from the different objectives have hills and curves and good cover concealment. So it's really hard to defend because you have too many objectives and not enough people. So you have 15 or so players and only 5 objectives. So you have to move your forces around to try and hang on to the objectives that you can. And the rotation is fairly fast. When you spawn up high on the hill. So don't have to defend people respawning. Like, people don't camp the graveyard. So that's kind of nice. You jump down in the direction that you want to attack whichever objective that you want. It's easy to kind of retreat and find some cover to heal up. So I was really fortunate in that sense that I had good battle groups to go in there with. Occasionally I would end up as battle group leader because I have a lot of stamina on my rogue. But somebody put down a huge rack of ribs for us, which gives you stamina plus 10%, which was a huge boost. Because when you have stamina plus 10% plus heroism on the first attack point, it just, you mash up the opposition really fast. I don't know where to get that recipe, though. That's a quite clever recipe. I think it might be one of the new Uldum / Veil of Eternal Blossom. You know, as you go around, you collect the questionable meat. That might be one of the recipes you learn from that. Because it's an incredibly handy recipe, and you can pop down the rack of ribs for everyone in the battleground. It was good for a raid group. So that was really, really good. I used up quite a few of the potions, the annoying one, like increase your mobility by 50% for 6 seconds. There was a demon hunter chasing me, and usually as an outlaw rogue, you can't do anything to a demon hunter, but he was chasing me on Twin Peaks. So every 3 seconds I would turn and I would pistol shot him, and he would be slowed down by 50%. So he could never quite catch up to me other than his 2 sprints. And then I would pistol shot, or I would shoot him between the eyes, which stops him in his track. And I would just stay ahead of his kill zone, because demon hunters really have a handy kind of mirror all the way around the target and kind of shark attack strategy when they get up on you. But if you can keep them 4 feet back, they can't hit you. They can hit you a little bit on the edge of, or the tip of the whatever they're casting. The eyes of destruction or whatever their eye beam, you can interrupt. So I've interrupted quite a few of those. Because my kick button's always on the 1. And I had such a really, really good time. Like, I played one or two Isla Conquests, and we lost the first one really bad. The second one, we did really good. We had where the entire Horde forces came back at the end into the to defend. It was just horrible. There was Horde everywhere. It was just a big pile of people stacked on top of the boss. And somehow we got the boss down, even though people were killing each other left, right, and center. And it was just like one big mess. And like all my job was to do is to interrupt the healers and to stun Warlocks. I still have a problem with. Warlocks are really well equipped with their destruction spec. If I'm by myself against a Warlock, I can't do anything, it seems, because the fear eventually overcomes my ability to do damage, and I don't have the range to close the gap on them. I think they also have a talent to be without a pet for some specs, because some of the Warlocks I never see the pet around them. It was just a really, really good battle group. I got my quest done for the week. I got 2 conquest upgrades, and even when I was losing, I was making about 300 honor, so I got an extra level on my leveling, and hopefully when I get to level 40, I'll get another mount, an Ablaster conquest mount, or whatever it's called. I don't really know the names of it until I actually have the mounts, because they're kind of nebulous. They give you the impression of that what you're going to get, but they don't give you the actual title of it, so you can look it up. And that's pretty much been my week. I'm on Winterhoof right now, sitting in the auction house with my mage. I think I should level her at some point. I have her magic broom swirling around everywhere. I would really like to do the Argent tournament on my paladin to earn another broom. Because buying an off the auction house for 40,000 gold seems a bit steep.
Yeah.
And that's been my week.
Oh, excellent.
Oh, how you doing?
I get giddy and love making mini alts. My dog is trying to poop for the horn and for the alliance. It was funny on my head.
Brilliant. How was your weekend? Wow.
I did a bunch of silly things. I'm trying to figure out different professions and stuff, and leveling up my lower level characters that aren't too much of a duplication of my higher level characters. You know, I'm on my two high, my only major. What is it? Max characters are Prillian and April at 120. Yeah. So, you know, a couple of them I wanted to do, particularly like me. Me is my other warlock. And I was looking at his profession, and for some reason I got enchanting and skinning. Is that not the two most stupidest? Because there's nothing you can get to disenchant from skinning. I mean, of course, maybe if I hook him up with somebody else, I'll be able to do something with him. He dinged 63... today, doing 62 today, doing Dark Moon Fair. I'm really loving the buff. It was funny because I took me and the April to Dark Moon. No, actually, I took them out. One of the things I do with Dark Moon Fair, and I don't know if anybody else does this, but if they have cooking, before I port them to Dark Moon Fair, I go and check the daily food quest right there, the daily cooking quest. Yeah. And today it was bacon, which, of course, is the best one. I mean, you just go
bacon's
in
bacon's plus two, right?
Yeah, it's plus two. Plus, you go in that little area, and all you have to do is, like, you can do an AOE.
Yep. Right.
And, bam, you've gotten your 6 things. Well, 2 things happened. The first thing was that even though they were partied up, me was using the extra buff for PvP, And me, April wasn't, so they were out of sync. And that was the whole waste. So they still fought. But V is 102 or 103, I think. And me is 61. And I forget, it's scaling. So me was getting the crap knocked out of them because the those pigs are 60. And, you know, you're so used to just going in and killing and stuff. But, yeah, we finally did it. We did some skinning, and we went to Dark Moon Fair, which is always fun. One of the things that happened at Dark Moon Fair that was kind of weird, and I know maybe I'm... And I feel like I'm being like those people that inspect other people unnecessarily, but I was only inspecting this person's buff, so I don't think it's that creepy. Her name was... Herwathia, I didn't see what guild or whatever she was in. But I only inspected her buff because she had a giant carp on her. And I was like, why is this person wearing a giant fish thingy? And it turned out she had number one fan, your Blight Boar's number one fan, resounding protection, vocals playing the crowd, Dark Moon Fair Firewater, Severed Crimson Scale, I kind of recorded the whole thing so I could go over it. Severed Crimson Scale Head.
Yeah.
it was just, she had all these different buffs, and it was just funny seeing them. A couple of them I didn't know about, so I was hoping. Void Ritual. It says participating in a Void Ritual. What does that mean?
I think it's a Battle for Azeroth thing.
Oh.
Yeah, that's corruption.
Okay. She had Neural Silencer. Immune to some annoyances, 10 hours that's remaining.
Engineering
thing, so they can't life grip you.
Okay.
Or
mind
control you.
Oh, okay, that's interesting. Enlisted, experience gained from killing... Oh, is that that's the buff that we all have, right? No.
That's the war mode.
That's the war mode.
That's war mode, yeah.
Okay, so yeah, because I have that one too. And Greater Blessings, that's a paladin thing?
Yeah.
And what was the other one? Oh, Green Dance Sticks. Holding Dance Sticks. 58 minutes remaining.
That's from doing the Black Knight event on Dark Moon Island. There's a cave you go into where the Black Knight is trying to kill whoever's there. But if you attack him and eventually survive the encounter, there's a dance competition afterwards. And whoever wins the dance competition gets green sticks.
Oh, okay. So she must have won. You mean there's a dance studio that we don't know?
Something like that, yeah. Undead dance studio.
Oh, so it's headbanging.
Yes. Exactly that.
You gotta love the undead dance. Male dance, because it's headbanging. And then the other thing I'm doing is I'm trying to finally finish... they grow up so fast. So right now I'm in Ungora Crater trying to do one more quest. And this quest is Searing Rock Feathers. What is... This, and it's so crazy because, you know, it's the one where you're getting the mount. So it's the... It's a skeleton raptor.
So you're almost done?
No, I have 13. And I'm pushing myself. Here's my pledge. I'm going to push myself. So by next recording, I should be getting number 14. But I always forget, sometimes you have to go to Tanaris. Right? Some of the quests are in Tanaris, not just in Ungora Crater.
Okay.
Yeah, and then the other thing I want to do is, one of the things on this calendar was that is there a pet battle coming up? Did I see pet bonus?
Yeah, on the 16th.
The 16th. Right, yeah. So I'm going to do some leveling up, but I have just been going over all the pets that I got from Duvisay, and they are amazing. And once again, I can't tell you enough. And I'm almost embarrassed to tell this other part, because I did want to do a shout-out to Duvisay. And I don't know, do you tell anybody else that that you play Pokemon? Duvisay is my Pokemon buddy. I have a couple of other Pokemon buddies, including someone on this podcast, but he has abandoned me, so... want to do a shout-out to Big G, because Big G still hasn't abandoned me, but someone else has.
I haven't abandoned you. It's just that I don't use my phone at the moment because I only use it when I go out.
Oh, okay. So you don't have any Pokestops near you?
I only have that one I told you about that's like just out of reach.
Oh.
On the other side of the road.
Oh, because I have, I have a couple in the complex. When I walk Mysia, I do peas, poops, and Pokemon.
Yeah. And I don't have any gifts left.
Yeah. And you know what happened though? And I know this isn't the Pokemon podcast, but I thought it was interesting. One of the poke spots I used to walk past every day commemorated a riot between African American citizens and Caucasian citizens in the early 1800s. And I went to, as I'm walking home, I went to click on it the day before yesterday. Not only is it gone, but the gifts that I got have a unknown poke spot symbol. Isn't that weird? Do you think they took it out because of the current events, or is it just a coincidence?
Well, I know in Europe, in England, they ripped the statue out of the ground that was in front of a public, a civil building, and they threw the statue into the river because it featured a slave trader from 1898.
Right, but this was something commemorating a historical event. And it was just weird. I have never seen a poke spot. I've seen poke spots appear, but I've never seen one just disappear. So that was kind of interesting. Anyways, and I guess that's about been my week. I'm going to be trying to finish up April. I still did not get an answer to my ticket. And so Aprilian can't progress on her allied quest thing. Maybe I need to...
Well, I just have to redo it. I don't know. Drop the quest and retake your quest. But she's not even going to giving you the possibility of...
I can't even do the withering quest. Every time I click on her, it says you cannot do this at this time. So, yeah. Has anybody else gotten that weird bug? Let us know.
You sure she's not downstairs as well?
No. In fact, that's the really weird thing about it is that it shows the question mark is shown downstairs.
Answer to the ticket?
Let me see. I saw a quick click on the question. Well, let me try. Right now, I just got the Withering Quest thing because it's a world quest. Let me see what happens.
So you should have gotten the UI window from Blizzard somewhere on your screen.
No, there isn't.
This is a answer to your ticket.
Nope, I did not. Maybe I need to do it again. I mean, I'm pretty sure I did everything right.
Or there is a letter from the devs in your mailbox.
Let me see. We're doing it live, folks. We're doing it live. Yeah, she's upstairs. The question mark is downstairs. No, nothing from the
dev.
Yeah. Oh, something from Construct. Oh, thank you, Construct. All right. And that's about been my week. If I hear anything else, I will get back to you. And if anybody has any ideas, let me know. I'm going to open up another ticket. It doesn't even say I have an open ticket, which is weird. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, let's try.
Oh, yeah. Aprilian, by the way.
Yes?
Raz reminds me, if you could promote my priest.
Where's your priest? What guild?
Call.
Okay. Caw or Clan of Darkness?
The Clan of Darkness.
Claw is on us.
I mess with it together.
What's your priest's name?
Kirilla.
All right, that's been my week.
Okay.
And now it's time for add-ons, spotlight, and a whole bunch of other things with Grand Negus. Oh, shoot. How's your week been, Grand Negus? Sorry, I was being attacked.
Oh, that's okay. As long as you're still alive, it's okay.
Yes.
I've been leveling over the last 2 weeks. I've finished leveling my mage to max and then shifted to the priest. So again, 120 max is the mage, and 114 at the moment, 115, almost 116 is the priest. She has been doing quite a bit of professions leveling. So she did. She's a minor engineer, and she started to unlock toys, engineering toys. The only one at the moment that she hasn't unlocked that is of importance is, it's not even a toy. It's the Chiefs, but the other ones that are toys that I care about, I've got unlocked now. The ones that I don't really care about are the world enlarger that I can't get because I'm not a gnomish engineer.
Right.
And the Snowmaster 9000, which I don't have the spec.
Schematics.
Yeah, the schematic for on any tune, strangely. Either always been too unlucky to get it to drop, or I didn't see the purpose of buying it. And when I eventually get it, I'm going to learn it and make it. But before, I'm not going to to...
You can make a whole snowball. You can make a whole snowball every day if you have a water in your bags.
Yeah. I can go to Outer Rock and pick one up. So who cares, really? It's just to get a toy in the toy box. That's all.
You know, the sad part is I used to make a snowball, put it on the auction house, and somebody would buy it. Why would you buy a snowball? Because they wanted to throw it in Iron Forge at somebody else.
Yeah. And then you have the Ludorang. That I understand that's kind of serves a purpose. Yeah. And I have it unlocked, but I'm just don't use it. So the items that I use and at the moment are the Molly, the mailbox.
Yeah, so handy.
And then the two toy Blinktrons, 4,000 and 5,000, because 6,000 and 7,000 aren't toys.
Right.
And then the wormhole generator, Pandaria, and Northrend. Oh, they're in the wrong order. And then the wormhole centrifuge, which is kind of the same thing, but for Draenor, the only difference with the ones that are higher from newer expansions are that, contrary to the wormhole generators for Northrend and Pandaria, you can not decide on where you land.
Right.
With the Pandaria and the Northrend one, you can pick a pre-selected spot in a zone. It's always with the other ones, it's totally random points throughout the entire zone, the entire geographical continent or zones of the respective expansions. So if I use the wormhole centrifuge, the one for Draenor, I'll get dropped off somewhere random on the entire planet of Draenor. Mm. Same thing with Argus. If I hit the wormhole generator Argus, it's going to drop me off in a random location on Argus, regardless of which of the three zones. That's like totally random. Same thing with the... And this is something that I didn't realize, because I just made these back when BFA was new. And then I set and forget, just made them to have them done, to skill them even, I can't remember. But the wormhole generators Coltiris and Zandalar are not, because one is red and one is blue. So I was under the impression, phrase this carefully. I was under the impression that the blue one was for the Alliance and the red one was for the Horde.
That sounds like a reasonable assumption. Them, yeah.
You couldn't use them with the other faction. And you could only use them on your respective continent. That isn't so. If you are an engineer, make both, regardless of what faction you are, because you can use both. If I, as my Volpira priest, if I use the wormhole generator called Tiras. It's going to teleport the player to a random location on Kul Tiras, regardless of my faction.
Oh, so you could actually end up in an opposite faction area?
I can be teleported to a random location on Kul Tiras, yes. If I want to go to Kul Tiras fast.
Yeah, yeah.
As a horde, I don't need to go to Dzaralor, fly down to the harbor and whatnot. I just hit my wormhole generator and then I pop up somewhere on Kul Tiras and fly from there. Use my flight master's whistle and I'm most likely faster at my location faster than I would be if I were to use my Hearthstone to go to Dzaralor. Same thing the other way around. If I want as a filthy alliance to go to
filthy alliance.
Of course.
If I want to go to Zandalar, I don't use my Hearthstone to go to Borealis. I use the wormhole generator Zandalar, and then use the flight master's whistle. In my, if I'm fast far enough away from a flight point, and then I fly there within the continent, which is probably faster.
Right.
So that's something that I discovered the other day, like a couple of days ago, when I reached 110. And was then able to, after learning Zandalari engineering, because that's when I learned it, when it registered, when I discovered it,
right,
that
when it showed
both
up.
Of these wormhole generators required Zandalari engineering. It didn't say Zandalari engineering with the one and Kul Tiran engineering with the other. So if I log into if you are a Fifth the Alliance player, it will say requires Kul Tiran engineering for you on both of the items. Excuse me?
Probably.
Almost guaranteed.
It's possible.
Yeah. All the respective item that corresponds with the version that, as a matter of fact, they are the same because I created them on my gnome rogue,
right?
The toys and learned them, so that must it is that's how it works. So, yeah, that's something to know if you haven't made the other one, respectively, you should do so. It's a nice thing to have, especially if you are a Horde player that wants to go to Mechagon.
Right.
And you are out in the wild. Normally you go back to Dzaralor, then fly down to the spot where the submarine is. And then you take the submarine, or you go to the ship, and then you go to most likely to a Stormsong Valley, and then you fly from there. But still, you need to go to Desire Law first, and then fly down to the ship or to the harbor area where the submarine is. So you can pretty much save that time by just using the Cortiras wormhole generator to get there way faster. And the good thing is it only has a 15-minute cooldown.
Oh, that's nice.
And they do not share cooldowns.
Oh, that's right. Even better. Yeah.
Yeah, it's very convenient. So 15 minutes is like nothing. If you compare that to any of the other wormhole generators, they have a 4-hour cooldown.
Yes.
So that's really, really convenient. So yeah, finally something that's okay again, that's good and useful. Well, the only really useful thing besides the scopes for the hunters that we got in the last two expansions as engineers, and again, if you don't count the Blinktrons that we have to make again because they're not toys, it's finally something useful. So I really hope that we get a little love again. Next expansion, Blizzard, if you're listening, let's see some engineer love again. Yeah, so I finished leveling my Pandaria engineering. I finished leveling my Cataclysm engineering. And I finished my vanilla engineering. The Northrend engineering, I'm quite a ways to max at 60 of 75. I need to get to 75 to learn the Jeeves schematic.
Yeah.
So that's still a bit off, probably another 2 or 3 hours of farming, because I need a whole slew of Serenite to
Wintergrasp. You do 3 flights around Wintergrasp, and basically you get 140 Serenite out of that, and you get some titanium, which you can sell the titanium if you're not going to use it. But the only irritating thing about farming about Wintergrasp is it's PvP. If you bounce into one of those filthy alliances and you both want the node, somebody's not walking away. But if you're patient, you let the alliance farm it, and when he flies away, it's still there for you.
Ah, oh, that's interesting.
Because it's up to 5 farms per cycle. So it doesn't despawn right away. So you don't have to fight them to get the node. You know what I mean?
Are you saying I'm chicken from a fight?
I'm just saying, you just land there and look at the guy and pretend you're going to attack him and just wait.
Yeah, no, I'm not going
to. And if he's not interested, then you go on farming your aerial away. That's what I do in Wintergrass. I go farm an undergeared character, and most of the time they go, he's not max level. I get nothing out of killing him. I don't even get honor. So if you're not max level, they usually just ignore you. You're not worth their time. You don't get an honorable kill out of it.
Interesting.
Yeah, because the horde is honorable. The Filthy Alliance doesn't do that. Sure. Yeah.
Well, this is...
No, it's Yeah.
I just got revered on my honey hive back rep. And from getting revered, I started finding large deposits of bee jelly. And from farming large deposits of bee jelly, I got 1,000 rep in about 15 minutes.
Oh, not bad.
So the idea that this is going to... Well, basically, the honey pots are spread out like the mining nodes. So if you don't fly too fast, you can spot the little ochre deposit, and you find large deposits, and the large deposits are worth basically 200 to 300 rep.
Yeah, my question though is it friends rep or is it regular faction rep amount?
You get faction rep, and you also get to feed the bee larva.
No, not what I'm asking. I'm asking, is it the 8,400 friends rep or is it the 2,100?
It goes 21,000. It counts on both. The bee larva goes up to 3,500, but it picks up very, very slowly. Mm-hmm. And the reputation goes to 21,000, just like revered. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But that one takes either 22, and with the wee buff, you get 24. So you get the 10% plus the human racial 10%. I know the evil alliance always have an unfair advantage, but it's only an alliance reputation. You don't get it horde side. So on your gnome or on your human, you could, if you have a human, you could earn this quite quickly if you have time to just fly around Stormsong Valley at Revered. Because at Revered, like I said, I got a 1,000 rep within 15 minutes. And if you see a little rainbow near the ground, that's the Honey Harvester event. You could join that in a raid group to get 800 to 1,600 rep just for killing stuff.
But it's a faction-bound mount anyway, so why would I care?
You would care if you want to show off while your gnome is riding through a horde-infested battleground, I guess. If you ever go into battleground as alliance,
my gnome flies her engineering mount. So
I think what I'll do is I'll put a screenshot of one of the medium nodes and one of the large nodes. That way people get a sense of what's in there.
Mm-hmm. All right.
So that's a regular node. Tiny. Okay. That's what I'll do. When I find a large node, I'll put it in comparison so people can have an idea, I revered what it looks like. I thought it'd be harder, but I didn't have to buy goggles or anything.
Maybe they
relaxed.
Maybe they took that requirement out.
It's possible. It's hard to tell exactly what Blizzard's intent is. I think they wanted to keep us in the game as long as possible.
Really?
There's so much advertising right now for Shadowlands everywhere.
Yeah.
I find it on Twitter. I find it on, my social media. And I find it every time I start up the launcher, play Shadowlands, explore. You know, I'm like, okay.
We can't play Shadowlands yet. Just saying.
But if you haven't upgraded your copy, it says upgrade is available. It always reminds you every time you log in.
I know. I mean, it's Blizzard that. Anyway, so another thing about Shadowlands, they apparently postponed the event that was supposed to take place on Tuesday on the 9th. So let me just quickly pull up the blue post. It says on MMO Champion Shadowlands reveal event on June 9th postponed. Blizzard has updated their news page to announce that they are postponing the June 9th Shadowlands reveal stream that was planned for next week. It is unknown when the event will occur. More important voices than ours need to be heard, and now is the time to listen. We are postponing our upcoming World of Warcraft Shadowlands live stream planned for June 9th and will share more details about the expansion in the future. So, yeah. I was really looking forward to it, to see what we were going to get, because apparently there was something, I don't want to say major, being revealed, because a reveal always sounds major in a way, like something huge, something important. And I was already starting to wonder if it's like a new big game mechanic or a big change or something like that.
Or VR.
Likely
VR.
Not, but yeah.
One can dream.
VR, once Shadowlands goes live, we can play it VR, as I mentioned a couple of weeks ago.
Right.
WoW will have full controller support. So, so that is that. And the other thing that I was thinking about when I heard that they were going to do a reveal, I was wondering, is that positive or is it negative? Because the big thing that we got as an announcement during the development of Warlords of Draenor was the fact that they were scrapping the two hubs that they originally intended to implement. Like the Boulder Fist, I think it's a Boulder Fist Citadel, like the big one in not Boulder Fist, the big citadel in Frostfire Ridge, and then the
Karabor Temple.
Temple of Karabor, what we know on Outland as the Black Temple. So that they were going to do away with those for various reasons. So I'm really not sure what they're going to do. Maybe some in-depth mechanics update or something like that. We did see quite a few changes now, and we saw where they updated like the Torghast stuff and the different class changes that they made. Not that I have looked much at it yet, because we can't play it yet. So,
you mean you're not in the alpha?
No, we're not. I'm not. So, it's something that I'm going to. If again, when people ask me why are you not looking at this, it's something. If you have something that's in development and you can't use it, you can't play it, then why look at it at a topic at the updates of a topic over and over.
Especially since so much can change. Since it's
exactly
implementation.
It'll change probably 2 or 3 or 4 times before we eventually maybe get access.
Right.
So then the if and when that happens, I can then go in and check on the most current updates and blue posts and posts on what the then current status is of the development. And I don't have to go through 10 different iterations of things that have changed and changed again, and the changes have changed and so forth. I don't need that.
Right.
So that's something that at least that's how I look at it. I know that that they have unlocked the last 2 zones now, Ardenweald. One more, Ardenweald, the Nightfae Covenant, which is, in my opinion, my second favorite after the Pentheia.
Mm.
Vampire people, because that's where should my warlock be fixed eventually, maybe where he is going to go. He's going to carry around a coffin on his back. Yeah, not going to have a cape on his back. He's going to have a coffin on his back.
Have coffin, we'll travel.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So that's and they apparently something to that I really want to eventually test out is they implemented chromy time walking, as they call it. Apparently, is the selection, the leveling selection of what you want what expansion you want to play in as you level your character.
Mm-hmm.
So when Shadowlands launches and you create a new character as a veteran player, meaning you've played it for X number of weeks, months, years, and this is not your first character on an account.
Okay.
Then you will get the option after you play to level 10 to then go to Chromie and ask and tell her, I want to do my leveling in either Kalimdor and Eastern Kingdoms. I want to go to Outland. I want to go to Northrend, Pandaria, Draenor, or Broken Isles.
At level 10?
At level 10, yes. And then you will level to level 50. Throughout that story.
Depending on which one you chose.
No.
Oh, you still go ahead, regular. Okay. And then when you get to 50?
Once you get to 50, you exit Chromie Time again, because that's when you go to Shadowlands. That's level 50 is your new level 120. So all your tunes, once Shadowlands pre-patch hits, because that's always when all the changes are implemented.
Gotcha.
All your tunes that are now 120 will be level 50. They're going to be squished to level 50.
Squish.
And, And then your leveling process in Shadowlands will take you from 50 to 60. And that's the new max. The same max level as vanilla, or in this case now, current classic. So, and if you want to play BFA, you don't need to talk to Chromie. You just go to the docks, or you go to whatever you go to the champions board and accept the quest to go to BFA. You don't need to go to Chromie for that. And if you are a new player, if you create a new account on a new Battle.net account.
Right, a total virgin account.
Exactly. You will automatically be put into two pre-selected leveling phases. One is a newly created introduction experience on an island to like familiarize yourself with your character
and keep you away from the people that might overwhelm exactly. you.
Yes, exactly. And that experience will take you from 1 to 10. And then at level 10, you will automatically, as the only choice, which obviously isn't a choice then.
Right.
The only option will be that you are going to play through BFA to catch up on the current story and the story that just precedes the Shadowlands content. So you know what events lead you into Shadowlands, which makes total sense in my opinion. So I'm fine with that. And again, if you want to do that as a veteran player, you can do that too. If you don't, you go to Chromie and talk to her and tell her you want to go and roam around on the Eastern Kingdoms or Kalimdor, or you want to go visit any of the other expansions. And then you start there at level 10, and then you should be done with the leveling to level 50 once you finish the leveling in that expansion with the last zone. Obviously, unless you cheat, quote unquote, and use heirlooms.
Why do you call that cheating? That is not cheating.
That is technically for the progression and for the experience that you get from playing through a expansion, the content of an expansion from end to climax to finish. It is cheating because you will be level 50 before, way before you reach that final, say you assault Icecrown Citadel as the last quest of Northrend, of the Wrath of the Lich King expansion. And you're done way before that, so that really doesn't count. And the purpose of you experiencing the entire expansion in a coherent, complete sense is, I don't want to say ruined, but it's
taken away from the whole full experience.
It's taken away because you
because now you
you get too much experience due to your use of heirlooms. So it is kind of cheating.
I think of it more as rushing. So if you've already experienced it, you don't need to see it. You can
semantics.
You say potato, I say potato.
There we go.
Let's call the whole thing off.
Yep. Okay. So let's do that. I want to warn people. As I scroll through my general chat at the moment, that's been going on for a couple of days now, and I've tried to ignore it as best I could in hopes that it would change with the newest update, which it hasn't, is the following. Let me read what my chat says over and over and over again every 30 seconds. It says, warning, DBM spell timers breaks DBM and must be disabled for DBM to function properly. So, question is, what's going on there? Does DBM not have spell timers anymore? Is it being incorporated into some other module or whatnot? I've tried to look up the curse page, but the curse page for DBM spell timers is gone.
Oh.
So it's kind of mysterious. There's been an update a couple of days ago, 2 days ago, and it didn't fix the issue. So I don't know. It's probably I haven't done any experimenting yet. I don't really know what's going on with that. So I just wanted to let people know that if your DBM is acting up at the moment, you might want to see what's going on. And I'm what that is. It's something that I haven't had before. I never had a module from DBM break.
Right.
Unless we had a major update where the author just was, I don't want to say maybe overwhelmed with the work needed.
Mm. And the changes.
And the things that break or whatnot. We all know that there are things that sometimes don't work the way that you expect them to. And Blizzard changes something last minute, even though the authors use the PTR as guidance and as the template, so to speak, to develop the changes and implement the changes. And then at the last minute or a couple of hours after the patch goes live, they push a hot fix and again something breaks. Yeah, so it's something that I really don't know what to think what it is. And I don't really know what.
And it's a weird situation because we appreciate the add-on people. None of them are getting rich. and they spend an awful lot of their free time working on these add-ons.
Right.
So whatever problems they have, all we can do is have patience and show gratitude when they do fix something.
Exactly.
Yeah. So Let's see what this turns into. Again, I couldn't see anything on the curse web page because it doesn't exist anymore. So there was nothing that told me, oh, this module doesn't exist anymore or it doesn't work anymore. The only thing that I could see was that this doesn't work anymore. For it to work, you must turn it off. But it didn't tell me, as I just stated, it didn't tell me it's broken or it's not needed anymore. Had it told me, oh, I don't need this anymore because it's been incorporated into another part of the add-on.
Or something Blizzard has done, because that happens sometimes.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, Blizzard will take up.
Yeah. So then I would have said, sure, okay, I know what to do, and I know why this happens. But it probably is just bad phrasing. Apparently it doesn't do much. I deactivated the module now, and it didn't break DBM completely. So we'll see what that turns out to be. And with that, that's been my week.
Awesome.
The chat room is making fun of the Alliance.
And you know, we love the Alliance, you know.
Speak for yourself.
They're special in their own way.
Speak for yourself, Aprilian.
Except for the bouncing female night elves. Ooh, did I say that out loud? I gotta go! I gotta go!
Is that what that is?
That's all I can think of when I see them bouncing like that.
Raz apparently is saying Alliance is WoW easy mode?
Yes. Well, you know, you know, the humans get money right away.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. It's definitely... Well, why do you think 12-year-old... never mind. We won't go there.
What? Well, I don't know. I've grown tired of starting every quest with a rusty dagger. Kind of want a clean one once in a while.
That would be nice. All right.
Yeah, I mean, it's no wonder that if you want to play a challenge tune, if you want a challenge. Yeah, you go and cheat by playing a night elf that has shadow meld, which is cheating.
Cheating, of course.
So yeah, it's easy mode, right?
Oh, did you hear? Asylum got her first max level in Battle for Azeroth an hour before the show.
Oh, awesome! Congratulations.
Ooh, rats. Nice.
Yeah.
One of us. Definitely. One of two of me. All right.
It's a challenge shoot. It's a WoW challenge shoot.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah, next level. Yeah.
You're kidding. What, a pacifist or an Iron Man?
I think it's an Iron Man.
Oh, my God. That's amazing.
She did it.
Now it makes me want to play my Iron Man tunes. I don't know. I could do that or I could just hit myself upside the head with a hammer.
I could pull my nails out.
Yes. I'm sorry. Kudos to everybody that can do it.
It's rough.
It's. Oh, wait. It's a challenge.
There you go.
Wow. Oh, yeah. Challenges. Mm-hmm. Sorry. Radzini has earned the achievement. Friend on the farm. Oh, how cute. am I saying that right? Raz Teeny.
Yeah.
All right.
No, it's still not it. Dang it.
I guess it's time for email now.
Email sucks.
Email. Email.
La data.
You've got mail.
Email. Who's next?
I'm addicted to you, baby.
Lovely little email. Give a big shout out to Kyle. We know he's got a lot on his plate, and we hope he's getting to play. We are going to miss a blast from the past. I look forward to it so much. Anyhow, but we do have an email, and our email is from rdog1984.
Oprah.
Is that because you were, and I believe that our dag is in the chat room, right?
Yes.
What pronoun can I use for you? And were you born in 1984?
Most likely, right?
You know, what I remember the most from 1984 is the Apple commercial. So 1984 won't be like 1984.
1984, what do I remember? I started my job training then.
Oh, wow. It was right before I moved to Boston. I was living in Maryland. Did our dag, are we saying your name?
He said no, he just picked the number at random.
Oh, okay. Yes. And he is a he?
I don't know. Is he a he? I think so.
Okay. Not that we're putting any pressure on you. You can be whatever you want to be. All right. Well, we got an email from you, and we really appreciate it. And it says, hello from RDAG1984. I've been listening to your podcast for a while now. Thank you. It's a fun and informative show, and I just want to thank you for putting it on for us. Aww. This week, I got the Goblin Heritage Armor. Awesome. So he did that thing like Aprilian did.
Mm-hmm. But only for the goblin.
For the goblin, yeah. You get sent back to Kazan to get it, which is kind of neat. Yes, that is neat. One of the boss fights was super crazy hard. I think it's part of the whole thing that you have to have one, because the one at, Kalazar, the island, Kalthazar? North of Silver Moon, yeah, that one, Colorado, was crazy hard. The boss had two attacks that took about 95% of your health and are hard to dodge. He is in a building with force fields on the doors to keep you in, but I was able to blink through them. Oh, how neat. You might be able to rocket jump through, though I didn't try, and if you run away from the starting spot, the boss will disappear. So I had to run around the building, keeping away from the attacks and shooting with arcane missiles and crucible of flame. It took 12 minutes, and I made a video of the fight. So there's a link to the YouTube video at controlaltwow.com, which also forwards to controlaltwow.blogspot.com. And that's CTRLALTWOW. There's another fight that's not as hard, but I still use the same technique. You have to clear the enemies around the building for that, but not the first one. So, thanks again for making the podcast. Awesome. Congratulations. And thank you for writing in and for being in the chat room. And Jarrell has earned the achievement Up Jade Complete. Who's Jarrell? Is it one of us or... Obviously, it's one of us.
Mm-hmm. It's us to us.
Oh. Well, complete the Jade Forest storyline. Good job. All right.
Yes, of course. And he's in the chat room, too.
Hey, what's up? Good to see, to have you here, and congratulations.
And he says, 1984, I was six.
Nice. And now's the time I get to play this.
We're Clan of Darkness here together. What's in an egg that we can't weather? Apocalypse. We've all been there. It's the same old boss. Why should we care?
We're clan of darkness here together. What's in an egg that we can't wear? There's nothing that we can't face.
Except for money.
Constructs, what's going on with Clans of Darknesses and Control Alt WoW? Nevikhoof and Wormmaster Cord.
I think people have been super, super busy doing leveling and questing because we have need for three songs and a whole bunch of leveling.
All right, well, let's do the levels first.
So at level 30, we have Matarita. At level 60, we have Iron Efficient. At level 70, we have Jiro. Level 80, we have Jiro. Level 85, Jiro. Level 90, Isabel. Level 100, Carilla. Level 100, we have also Gwyneth. And at level 110, we have Carilla. And
you need a song for three people?
For three people.
Funny how time flies when you're having fun. And who had become exalted with the Clans of Darknesses or Control?
Becoming
all
exalted with Clans of Darkness this week, our Clan of Darkness II on Wormrest Accord, on Earthen Ring US, and on Winterhoof. We have Gwyneth. I know that's Duvise.
Who?
We have Jiro. And we have Isabel. Congratulations. Well done, people. You can buy our stuff.
Good job. Yes, at the guild vendor. Good job. I'm so proud of you guys. All right, so let's get out and do our boats now or tomorrow. It goes away on Tuesday. Yes. All right.
Another cloud. My God.
No, it goes away on Monday. I'm sorry. Monday night at 11:59. Mm-hmm. And that's in Thousand Needles, which is now underwater, which used to be a desert. And we'll be recording next Sunday, same time, 5 o'clock in 1 week, for episode 667. Shout out to Kyle. Shout out to Jeppy. I've been wanting to surprise you guys with Jeppy, but it hasn't worked out. But we're hoping that soon he will pop up, and you'll be super excited, like I am.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to add? Oh, shout out to Duvise. Again, I can't begin to tell you how much I am enjoying these pets. You are super duper awesome.
Raz asked when you're going on tour.
I wish we could. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Yes.
Probably referring to your awesome singing.
Oh. Thank you. That's so sweet. So sweet. All right. So, this is the Prillion for the Horde.
This is Constructs for those evil, evil alliance.
This has been Grand Negus, Rule of Acquisition, number 19. Satisfaction is not guaranteed. Bye, guys.
Guys. I have done...